Pastor Timothy asked me to give a personal testimony. I'm thankful for the opportunity, and I think that my personal testimony kind of goes with what's been preached here the last few weeks, and it's really encouraged this morning, and especially one place where he talked about how can I love a God like that? And when he said, you know, that's true, how can, that is a problem. And that's what I found in my life. My problem was not loving God. And in recent months, I've had times of encouragement. I've had times of being down. And it seems like where my selfish, proud nature has upper hand and I feel fruitless in the Lord's vineyards, I had some encouragement. Though recently, my daughter's church goes out on Grand Rapids, and then they go and witness on the streets, give gospel tracts, and I have joined them, and I have been encouraged. I again found joy in my heart. But the thing I feel to be the most significant truth that I learned over my Christian experience is something that Paul exhorted the Colossians. And that is not to be moved away from the hope of the gospel. And that's sometimes when I try to improve myself, try to do better, my hope is not in myself. My hope is in the gospel. My hope is in that Christ died for sinners. My hope ain't in myself. And over the years, reading sermons and hearing sermons, I would be convicted of certain sins. And the psalmist exhorts us, "Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee." And so I would hide God's word in my heart, thinking that would help me from sinning. It would show me my sin, and it may restrain me from my sin, but it really didn't keep me from sinning. You know, I'm a German, so Germans are kind of grumpy and complaining, murmuring, you know, we just, that's my very nature. And so I would memorize, "Neither murmur ye, as some of them murmured, and was destroyed of the destroyer." Now that's a very strong verse. You think it would put the fear of God in my heart. I would quit complaining, I'd quit murmuring. But I found that it didn't do that. And also in Philippians, there's a verse concerning murmuring. There's much in the Old Testament about murmuring. I also shamefully talked about individuals behind their back, and not always good. So I was convicted of that. And so I'd memorize certain verses concerning this, such as Psalms 15. Where it speaks, "Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell on thy holy hill?" One of the things, I'll skip over a verse because it's time's sake, but one of the things is, "He that backbiteth not with his tongue, nor doeth evil to his neighbor." You say that disqualifies me for heaven, backbiting my neighbor? And that's a very, again, very, if you take the scriptures as they are, it's very serious. And yet, it didn't keep me from backbiting my neighbor. It was still there. Again, being a male, I had a problem with sexual lust. So I memorized what Jesus said, "Whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. If thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee, for it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell." Again, very strong warning. Pull out your eyes, cast them out. And yet, found a strange hardness in my heart that didn't keep me from lusting after women. And then, of course, I can think of the selfish nature, and you can think of Philippians where it says, put others above thyself. I memorized that. Did it help me to put others above myself and think more about them? No. Again, there was a strange hardness in loving the honor of men. So I'd memorize, how can you believe which receive honor one from another and seek not the honor that comes from God only? You know, I was out on the streets the other night talking to these kids. They were, one said they were satanic and they were this and that and hated Christ. And I tried to deal with them concerning the pride of their heart. Pride goeth before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. And one kid made a smart aleck answer to me. I forget what it was. It was like God had me look right at him. And because right when he made the smart aleck answer, he looked at all his friends. I said, you care about what all they think, but you don't care anything what God thinks. And that's the way I am. I'm more concerned with what everybody thinks about me. But I don't really care what God thinks about me. That's the way I was. And so, the problem with pride, I can't humble myself. Being from Nebraska, I loved college football. And I would pray, God, show me if this is wrong. And he showed me. Well, I'm walking the trails in Peoria. It's idolatry. Very, very clearly it came to me. So now I got it. I'll quit loving football. No. No, I didn't quit loving football. I still loved it. I still thought about it. It was my meditation. All these scripture warning should have put the fear of God in my heart, yet there was a strange hardness where I wasn't moved. I continued in my hardness of sin. I professed faith in Christ, but there was an unbelief in my heart concerning the warnings of God. And the conclusion I came to was my only hope was in the mercy of God. Because he says, so then it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy. Yeah. And that only way, I finally came to God, if you don't have mercy upon me, I'm justly condemned. I'm going to hell. And I don't even really feel a broken heart. And that's when God broke my heart. But I want to, that ain't the end. My hope is still in the gospel. I think of what Peter said to the devout religious people on the day of Pentecost after they were pricked in their heart. He says, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Repentance is simply agreeing with God. He said, you crucified the Lord of glory. Some of them may have kind of argued. I wasn't even there. But that's what Peter laid on him. But he said, repent, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, for the promises unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And that's in Romans, as what Pastor Timothy's been preaching. I see Paul in Romans as a prosecuting attorney. prosecuting the Gentiles, then prosecuting the Jews and religious people. And the conclusion is that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. So we just would stop our mouths and hope in God's mercy. We have nothing to offer Him. I think of the promise of the gospel. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, curses of everyone that hangeth on the tree. Then the promise that the blessings of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. I want to make this real quick, but in Ezekiel 36:25, he says, then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean from all your filthiness, and from all your idols will I cleanse you. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. I will take the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them. That's my hope, that God would sprinkle clean water. Who is the gospel for? It's for filthy, hard-hearted idolaters. And that's why Paul starts in Romans 1, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. It is for sinners. I qualify. Thanks.